ahead, slowing down and making no time. I gotta keep it rolling. Those in the windshield wipers slapping out the tempo, playing fucking rhythm with the song on the radio. I gotta keep it rolling.
Hey, welcome everybody to the Rideshare Rodeo Podcast. Not the most fun week, actually. Not the topic I was hoping to talk about. I mean, I knew we'd be talking about it, but I was hoping something else would have stopped this already by now. Luckily, I am joined by Karen Anderson, who in my book has become more of a labor expert than most of the labor experts. So Karen, thank you for joining.
Hey Steve, how you doing?
I'm good. I just you know, I'm glad you're here because I feel like when you talk to even, you know, people, elected officials and whatnot, I feel like, you know, you're explaining, no, that's not right. No, it's this. No, it's, I understand they can't know everything, but I feel like they really are in the dark about a lot of this. And the more people that get their light switch turned on, I feel like very few of them stick with the, okay, we hate this. You know, it's like if they really get into a conversation and learn about it, they see there is no win in this. So we're going to hope to be joined by April, as you guys know her at least on YouTube, raised on Scrabble, if she's able to join us. But we're going to talk about the U.S. Department of Labor new worker classification. Final rule is now effective today, March 11th, 2024. So Karen, in January, we already knew about all this, but in January, the DOL rolled this out. We have a second term acting secretary who cannot be pushed through no matter how much they kick her into the hole and they're trying to get, you know, that square block through the round hole, and she's just not going to go. And so I don't even know how to take that. Unpacking this thing, I don't even know. Maybe a good start would be, now that it's in effect, and I know there's a lot of compliance challenges and other things like that going on, but how would you compare this to AB5 and how it rolled out and, you know, how it will look? Because I know that it's a different test. The six-factor test is a different test.
Well, AB5 in California, just to catch your listeners up who aren't aware of it, is a anti-independent contractor law that went into effect in January 2020. And with that one, it was a very much more draconian test than the one that the DOL has rolled out now. So you either passed it or you didn't. And we had hundreds of thousands of people losing their livelihoods overnight from across the vast swath of professions. It wasn't just about Uber and Lyft and gig workers. It was about every single person who works in California is under the purview of AB5. So this new DOL rule is sort of inspired by AB5 in a way. It has a lot of the same components in the six factors. The six factors are a totality of the circumstances, and they added a seventh factor that is kind of mysterious, and nobody really, they can apply anything they want to that seventh factor. So with this one, unlike AB5, which has exemptions, this one has no exemptions. And it's a 339-page rule. And right. Really, when you read through it, if you want to feel like you're reading Dante's Inferno descending into the, you know, nine circles of hell or whatever, then please, you know, read the 339 pages and tell me how a typical contracting relationship can pass, you know, if they really want to find you to be misclassified. There's enough leeway in this rule to find that. And so I think, you know, what we're most worried about is the chilling effect, where the risk averse business is going to err on the side of caution and just eliminate their independent contractors altogether, because everybody's being told to evaluate their contracting relationships. So the HR departments and the compliance officers and the attorneys are all probably looking carefully at all their independent contractors and, you know, in the various businesses and deciding, you know, whether we want them to risk continuing working with independent contractors or not. But as far as converting them into employees, that didn't happen in California, and it's not likely to happen with this DOL rule.
So we are joined by April now. Hi, April. How are you?
Hi. Hi, I'm good. Sorry, I was a little busy and running behind, but I'm here.
That's okay. So in the new DOL, you just said there's a seventh factor now, Karen. So the six factors are opportunity for profit or loss, depending on skill, investments by the worker and the potential employer, degree of permanence of the work relationship, nature and degree of control, extent to which the work performed is an integral part of the employer's business, and skill and initiative. What's the seventh factor?
They don't say. They say it can be anything they want it to be. It's right there in the rule. We've got a seventh factor, and it can be anything we want it to be. So you tell me what that could be. But as far as what you're reading out, you got to read the actual interpretive guidance that goes with along with all those factors.
Sure. I'm just pointing them out because I wanted to see if there was an actual, like the seventh one just sounds like it's like other.
Other, yes. Yes, so
could be anything else.
I mean, so for me, like I'm actually very worried about it because I have a client that I do a weekly column for, and I have for a long time. But I don't pass at least three of those factors, including the permanence factor. You know, they only want you to be doing one-offs or, you know, occasional random assignments for your client. Otherwise, if you have a, you know, an anchor client that we call them, you know, in the writing profession, where you have assignments, you know, every week, like a weekly columnist, you know, or somebody mm-hmm. who writes a monthly newsletter, that by definition, by their own definition, the USDOL in their interpretive guidance is an employee. And then you add the other factors to that, like if it's a fixed rate every month, or if it's integral to the business, which is equivalent to the B prong of the ABC test, you know, and then it starts weighing in favor of employee status. And before you know it, you're terminated by your client because you don't pass.
So nobody knows, but I mean, in your best guesstimate, is this going to be like obviously it'll be a slow rollout. Like I was telling you, there's some people saying, and I heard this yesterday, and it was getting under my skin a little bit, because nobody should be saying, don't worry, you won't be affected.
Nobody should be saying that at all.
That nobody. I mean, that's an irresponsible comment, is it not?
It absolutely is.
Okay.
And especially if you're dealing with a risk averse business, like I say, it's the chilling effect. You might be, mm-hmm. you might fall under the radar if somebody isn't paying attention to you, or there's never a claim made, you know, under the Fair Labor Standards Act. But if the chilling effect is just getting terminated, you know, altogether. Because the fines and penalties for misclassifying a single independent contractor can be massive when you've got these lawsuits, you know. This is under the Fair Labor Standards Act. So there's actually, there are a lot of people very worried about this. The trucking industry, for example, a group of truckers in Louisiana filed a lawsuit. And just on Friday, they filed a motion for a temporary restraining order, which is exactly what happened with AB5 on the eve of AB5 on the New Year's Eve 2019. The trucking industry in California filed an emergency TRO, and they were able to obtain a preliminary injunction to keep the enforcement of AB5 off of the trucking industry for 2.5 years while they fought it out in court. So the same thing could happen with this lawsuit. There's two other lawsuits with.
But was that not too because of the pandemic?
No, it had nothing to do with the pandemic.
They're like 2.5 year. Okay, right. I thought maybe that was a little bit pandemic related.
No, it hadn't. They were able to operate as independent contractors in California for 2.5 years while they fought it out in the courts. And when it finally, the litigation reached the dead end with the Supreme Court, then in June of 2021, AB5 all of a sudden was in effect on the trucking industry. And that's when you saw all the truckers, you know, protesting at the ports. But then you had the stupid people in the media who don't understand AB5 saying, oh, AB5 is all of a sudden under in effect, or Or with Prop 22, they say, oh, it's been repealed. You know, people think AB5 doesn't exist anymore. And there's just, like you said, there's just all sorts of misinformation flying around about everything.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of, and that's why I like bringing people like you and even April here today. You know, she always has good questions, so I'm sure she'll come up with some. Like, that's why I like having these type discussions, because if you're just talking and you don't know about this stuff, you really need to be careful, because it spreads like wildfire. All of a sudden, everybody's thinking, "No, I'm safe." And in this one, especially, from what I can tell, and from the lawsuits filed. And what's going on already that we're all preemptive, there's no way to tell. And it's even different. One thing that happened with AB5 that I've learned from you, Karen, is they divided the group. Not only did they do the carve outs for the lawyers and the doctors and the anesthesiologists and stuff, but then they took the larger groups. Let's carve them out, literally, because they were just adding to the fire that was trying to stop it.
Yeah, like musicians were, you know, a lot of sectors and professions got exemptions right from the beginning with AB5. I think there was about 60 of them, and they were mostly white collar professions like doctors and lawyers and accountants and, you know, architects and things like that. But still, they're still under the AB5 restriction, because a lawyer can't hire an independent contractor paralegal to work for them on behalf of a client. So it's still, even if you have an exemption, like an architect, I have an architect in my group who has an exemption, but he can't easily contract with a renderer or a graphic designer or a web designer or whatever, you know. So it just throws a wrecking ball into every single kind of traditional contracting relationship that you can think of, you know. And it's a complete and total mess in California, and it's by no means has it been repealed. It's still alive and well, and it's wreaking havoc on hundreds of thousands of people in California. So this new rule is sort of inspired by AB5. And the acting Secretary of Labor, Julie Hsu, came from California, and she was an endorser and enforcer of AB5 before she joined the Biden administration. So she's right. The one that's going to be, you know, touting the new rule and claiming, oh, it's not really like AB5. But,
yeah, she was on a morning show this morning. I don't remember which one she was on. I think she was on the CNBC one. But she was talking about labor statistics about new jobs and stuff. And I don't actually believe those reports anyway. I've been reading a lot of articles that a lot of these new jobs are called soft. I don't know how to refer to it. Soft jobs, or like they don't really exist. But companies are putting out, hey, we're hiring this, 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 and this, but they maybe need one person, but they're putting out five listings.
Oh yeah, we have a radio journalist. Radio journalists do not have an exemption from AB5, even though supposedly journalists have an exemption. Well, all of her previous clients, instead of hiring her on as an employee, they put her on payroll and never use her anyways. And so there's just a lot of smoke and mirrors about all of the exemptions. But with the DOL rule, there's no exemptions at all, and there never will be, because it's a federal regulation. It comes from the Department of Labor, and who's going to be enforcing it would be the Wage and Hour Division, you know, with audits and investigations, you know, and bureaucrats basically, and judges, you know, deciding, you know, if somebody's an independent contractor or not. And there's enough leeway with all the interpretive guidance to find in favor of being an independent contractor if they really want to find in favor of that. You know, all you have to, and I really encourage people to pull up the actual 339 pages and wade through it, and you'll see.
You're telling people to go read this Harry Potter novel
about this. It's like AB5. The ABC test is only, what, 75 words, but all the interpretive stuff around it and all of the restrictions and the exemptions and all of the legal mumbo jumbo is like 5 or 6 or 7,000 words. So the more words you have, you know, piled on to the test, as supposed interpretive guidance creates more confusion. And it's arbitrary, it's capricious, and that is the basis of some of these lawsuits. You know, the the Civic Legal Foundation on behalf of Fight for Freelancers. There's four freelance writers, three in New Jersey and one in Georgia, who filed a lawsuit. And then there was another group of two freelance journalists in Tennessee who filed a lawsuit. And then there's a trucker's lawsuit coming out of Louisiana against this DOL rule. And they just filed a motion for a temporary restraining order just this weekend to try to put a stop to the rule altogether. And then there's another previous lawsuit that's was in a federal court in Texas that could also, you know, throw a wrench into the proceedings. And then you have Representative Kevin Kiley.
Is it this one?
What is that?
No,
I'm not talking about that one. Okay. That one is another one. What was I trying to say? I lost my train of thought.
Well, the other thing is, with all this, there's not going to be any rhyme or reason. Like, you could, just because somebody comes out of a meeting and says, "Hey, I got cleared. I can be an independent contractor." It doesn't mean everybody else that does that gets to go, "Okay, I can go home. I don't have to go into my meeting now." It's like each person's going to be on their own.
I mean, I can tell you what's happening to me right now. I have a long-term client who, a publishing company that I get a lot of work from, and I have for years, and they just sold it to a new owner. And I just was informed that, my current invoice is on hold while they examine their accounts payable and their workers. So in light of the new rule, coming into play, I could very well lose that client because of the new rule, even though I have a quote unquote exemption from AB5, because these people in other states, they don't care about my measly exemption in California. They're just going to go, psst.
Well, we learned in California when it happened, everybody became toxic. You've said that yourself. Kim said it. Mike has said it. A lot of people have said it. Like, hey, overnight, everybody became toxic. Well, doesn't that mean that today everybody just became toxic? Because the hiring entities are now like, I don't know if I'm safe to do this.
That's exactly right. If you're a freelancer, you have the sword hanging over your head and possible target on your back, and you can't really breathe a sigh of relief. Not really. And to circle back, what I was trying to say was the Representative Kevin Kiley and Senator Bill Cassidy have both issued these Congressional Review Act proposals, and on the House side it's Resolution 116, and on the Senate side it's SJ Resolution 63, I think. And that is to try to overturn this regulation via, you know, legislation. So what people can do is to try to contact their own senators if they have not co-sponsored these resolutions yet. What John was asking about, the joint employer one, that actually that a similar thing is happening in the National Labor Relations Act, or the National Labor Relations Board, which unlike the Fair Labor Standards Act, which is what we're talking about with independent contractors and minimum wage and overtime and that kind of thing, the National Labor Relations Board deals with, you know, unions and collective bargaining and that kind of thing. And so there was a joint employer rule that the DOL or the National Labor Relations Board implemented, that was going to really restrict and almost upend the franchise model in the United States. And so what John was asking about there, that a judge on March 8th just vacated that rule. I mean, vacated it. So, and they had a there was a CRA on that one too. So that kind of bodes well a little bit, you know, for us to telling us that, yeah, a judge could come along and vacate this rule because it's so arbitrary and capricious. And it also violates the Administrative Procedures Act, which is a whole nother, you know, line of attack for why this agency shouldn't be be by decree, you know, controlling so much of the economy without showing how what the negative effects would be.
So, April, I want to ask you. So, if pretend like Karen had an answer, because she can't have an answer because we don't know how anything will go. But pretend like she was the one that you had to approach. What would your question to her be? Because you've been in both the traditional and the app-based space.
I have, and actually my current main gig that I consult for, the biggest change that they have had to make as a result of this, everyone that was under a non-compete clause, they had to get rid of those as of today, which, no offense to anybody, I think is a great thing. I am curious, though, about how you, not using California as an example, because the Department of Labor is a little different. I'm a little curious about how we foresee this being enforced, because I've told many drivers that in a lot of cases, I feel like drivers are a little less exposed than, say, someone like me who does logistics consulting for the company that I used to be a W-2 employee for once upon a time.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm curious what the enforcement aspect is going to look like for these companies, because that was a lot of pages and a lot of rule and a lot of cloudy language when I read through that 300 plus pages.
The enforcement comes from the Department of Labor wage and hour division and bureaucrats mm-hmm. in the little cubicles in their, you know, regional offices. And so if there's a claim filed under the FLSA, which has to do with minimum wage and overtime, it could result in huge, huge class action lawsuits that, you know, that would turn into settlements, you know, on larger industries for misclassifying independent contractors. And so the DOL would conduct audits, and it also end up in courts in front of judges. So those are the two ways that it would be enforced.
But would it be
it's not enforced against the independent contractor. It's enforced against the hiring entity who hires the independent contractor.
Right, which is where the fear, that's where my concern with, when I hear people, like I heard a couple of people saying that gig workers won't be affected. Okay, well, look, just for a minute, app-based ones. Just for a minute, let's play devil's advocate on this, because, okay, let's say that the gig workers aren't affected. They probably wouldn't be. But now it's going to be a fear in the company's eyes. And April knows as well as I do, and I was telling Karen before we went live, that we've seen 100 times over the gig companies take a bite from any kind of legislation or anything. They take it right out of the drivers right away. Heck, we've seen in other cities, they've taken it out of the customers. They've started punishing their customers for legislation.
Well, their first goal and their only goal is to not pay for any of these things that may cost them extra money. And we know that. They're going to take it between the drivers, between the customers. They're not paying for any. They haven't paid for any legislation that's passed yet, and they're not going to. That is not their model.
I guess my point there being that, I mean, just don't think that because, maybe they won't come after you, person X that drives in Georgia, but they might come after the company that you're working for, who then will take it out on you. And in what Karen's saying, you know, the fear factor of like putting this fear into the hiring entities, these entities become very like, I don't know if I want to do this. Cause I mean, I know in California, the fines are extremely high.
It gives them, the rule gives them one more tool in their arsenal, you know, these unions and labor proponents to go after a single industry. So it's just one more tool. So, you know, it could be metastasized into, you know, it inspiring new regulations and new case law, you know, either via legislatures in different states or in the courtrooms, you know, using this. You know, the rule that we had in place before that went into effect right after the Trump administration, right at the very end of the Trump administration, they call it the 2021 rule.
Yeah,
so that, you know, gave a lot more clarity to how to can be an independent contractor. It was clear, you know.
Yeah, it made it very easy.
Right. But as far as this, the one thing that people are going to read that is not true is that there was no labor rule. There was no rule before the 2021 rule in regards to independent contractors under the Fair Labor Standards Act. They relied on case law dating back 70 years, so anybody could pick and choose any kind of case law they wanted to make a case against somebody's status, so there was no Obama rule. So put that off. Get that off of your, out of your head, because they try to trick you. Some of these labor writers and politicians, there was no Obama rule whatsoever.
Yeah.
It was just law.
Right. And so I was reading John's comment here about, here's my question on this. So he's talking about putting every member of Congress on record as to how they're standing, I'm guessing, with this. So what? I mean, aren't they willing to stand by, at this point, aren't they willing to stand by what they're picking?
Well, I think there's 54 congressmen that are signed on to Kevin Kiley's resolution, and there's a lot more senators than I thought too. There are some Republican holdouts, I heard through the grapevine. Because they don't want to appear like they're anti-labor or whatever. But for the most part, there's no Democrats at all. This is all fueled by labor unions and Democrats in the Biden administration. If you don't think they're coming after you as an independent contractor, you are whistling past the graveyard, because they are. And Biden promised it when he was campaigning in 2020. He praised AB5. He wanted to see the ABC test implemented in tax, labor, and employment laws. Labor law being the National Labor Relations Act, which deals with collective bargaining, that kind of thing. And employment law, which is the Fair Labor Standards Act, which is what we're talking about with independent contractors. And that's what they want. And in fact, the Department of Justice has just chimed in on Olson versus State of California in support of AB5 in a case that's going to be heard. It's going to be heard on March 20th. In an on-bank review. So, his administration has made itself very clear. They like AB5. They think it's a good thing, even though Julie Sue treats it like a hot potato.
Yeah. I mean, well, also, I mean, are we not even questioning Julie Sue's non-authority anymore? Because I am.
A lot of people are. She's still the acting Secretary of Labor. She hasn't been voted on yet. Biden has renominated her, and then they had some kind of behind the scenes closed door hearing with Bernie Sanders where, the Republican senators weren't allowed to be in the room and ask her questions. I mean, and she is no friend of independent contractors. Trust me, she's bought and paid for by the unions.
Oh, I'm just saying, like, I question her authority.
I do too, because she's not the actual labor secretary. She's still the acting. She became the acting. She was deputy secretary of labor, and then Marty Walsh, who was the labor secretary,
took a better job with the NHL.
Took a better job with the National Hockey League, mm-hmm. And so she became the next in line to be nominated for to take his place, and she failed in that nomination process. They were never able to vote for her because she didn't have enough votes. So Biden's
that's what I'm wondering, how long she can just sit there.
It's beyond me. I don't know.
He can stay there until the end of the term. There's a precedent for it now. So there's nothing you can do about that.
Why are they renominating her?
Oh, they'll do it over and over the same way. I mean, that was one thing President Trump did start a bit of a precedent with acting secretaries. So they'll wait until this election this year, and then she'll cycle out when that happens. That's
I can't disagree with you there. She probably will. You know, it could be she's a lame duck, or it could be that they think that she's proven herself enough where she can get enough votes. But, you know, you have Manchin leaving, Sinema leaving. Neither one of them wanted to vote for her. I know, because I met with them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So she'll probably, more than likely, she'll cycle out with the next administration, however that lands. And either way, the rule is going to happen without some court intervention, or the rule has happened without court intervention, no matter who's the acting secretary. So that's the only reason why I don't focus on her legitimacy, because the rule is here, no matter.
Yeah, the rule. Yeah, exactly. The rule is here. She's been in this purgatory situation for a while. Can't figure out what to do. And then we have a vote. We have a presidential election this year.
I'm part of a campaign a new campaign that's launched called Save Independent Work with California Business and Industrial Alliance. And part of our campaign is about Julie Sue. You know, she does not belong in the position that she's in. And there is quite legality questions about whether she can unveil these massive regulations while she's just an acting secretary. So I don't know. I don't know. It's just one more tool in the arsenal to fight it. And it's one more thing that the opponents of this rule, like Kevin Kiley, will point to.
Yeah.
So this article of Kim's, or am I allowed to even say that? I don't even know what I'm allowed to say about that. That Kim sent us last night, that she said this is okay to. I saw that it was published on March 6th. I mean, like, of course it would be okay for us to use it, right? Because even if we didn't have her permission, we could have strolled across it. So I'm just being a little cautious here, but
no, it's published, it's in print, it's public.
Right. So I mean, but I mean, it's talking about all these, you know, franchise owners, solopreneurs, independent contractors, encouraged to proactively reach out to their lawmakers. Are we too late in the game now?
No. No, if you just sit back and roll over and play dead, they don't think that it concerns you. You have to let your representative know you're worried about this.
Yeah.
You know?
I guess that's a question of mine. What stage are we in now then? Because the rule just went in effect. So now what?
Well,
are we still trying to get people's attention to, like, hey, do you understand this? Or
there's on that saveindependentwork.org, there's a form you can fill out to contact your representative to say, hey, look, I'm worried about this. Can you please support this congressional review act proposal? You know, the Independent Women's Forum, who I'm also in a coalition with, they have they have pages, the form letters that you can go online and find your representative and write them a letter and let them know. You know, it's like, it's just like,
that's the IWV.org, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. I mean, if you're just going to be complacent, then it's going to be death by a thousand cuts, you know?
Yeah.
And that is really,
well, I just didn't know if, like, your advice personally was if there was a next level, like, okay, now it's time for this.
The next level is really to contact your representative and say, what the hell is going on? What the hell, DOL, what are you doing? You're threatening my livelihood. You know, and it's not just, it's like in California, we have over 600 categories of professions that are affected by AB5, you know? And so, you know, we're not just talking about gig workers or janitorial or agriculture or certain kinds of industries that people associate with, you know, exploited, misclassified independent contractors. You're talking about every kind of profession under the sun, from event planners to wedding photographers to nurse anesthetists, healthcare professionals, independent theaters,
nonprofits,
performers, nonprofits, filmmakers, you name it. There, it
yeah, when I look at the film industry alone, there's so many of those that you have listed in your 608 or whatever it is.
Right. I mean, if writers weren't worried about this, they wouldn't have gone to the trouble of filing a lawsuit. I'm a writer. I am worried about it, even though I have an exemption from AB 5. Mm-hmm. I'm worried about it. I have a partial exemption.
Can you kind of explain the partial exemption? Because I know there's probably a writer out there going, wait, I don't have one, and that lives in California, and they're going, wait, why do you have one?
Well, every exemption comes with fine prints and caveats that have to be met before you can take advantage of the exemption. So when you read about AB 5 and they say, oh, well, AB 5 was so horrible that they had to grant 100 emergency exemptions and 100 professions are exempt. Well, that is just really just mythology, because when you really examine what's going on, a lot of the exemptions come with 11 hoops that you have to jump through. So like, for example, a tutor, most tutoring companies cannot meet the 11 requirements of the tutor's specific exemption. And speaking of tutors, there is a California-based tutoring company called Cambly who when the day that the DOL rule was published, which was January 10th or January 9th of 2024, they sent out a letter to all of their independent contractors in New Jersey and Massachusetts saying, because of this new regulation, we're giving you warning that we are going to have to terminate all of your contracts. And your termination starts March 11, 2024 today because of new regulations within the DOL. It says that right in the termination letter. So anybody who's telling you that this isn't going to happen, it's already happening. Tutoring companies already laid off independent contractors in certain states because of this rule.
Yeah. So, I mean, even John here is saying like exemptions don't matter now. But what is the FLSA?
No, John is not right. John's not correct. But the AB5 supersedes the FLSA. You know, in other words, my exemption should protect me, but he's correct in saying that it might not, just out of the fact that there's so much confusion that people hiring me from another state or whatever as an independent contractor aren't going to even bother noticing that I have a so-called freaking exemption in California.
Right. They're not even going to call their lawyer about it. They're just going to move on to the next thing.
The FLSA rule is not supposed to supersede my exemption.
So he says state law supersedes federal?
Labor law, yep. The FLSA is for minimum wage and overtime. It has nothing, this rule has nothing to do with determining whether you're eligible for unemployment benefits or workers' comp or collective bargaining or IRS taxation or anything like that. It doesn't have anything to do with any other federal agency. It only has to do with minimum wage and overtime and then child labor. FLSA. So minimum wage, federal minimum wage is $7.25. But a person like me or April or whomever who feels that they might be misclassified could file a claim, you know, and get attorneys involved and jumpstart a whole class action against an entire industry based on overtime alone, unpaid overtime alone under the Fair Labor Standards Act. And the DOL prosecutes these all, not prosecutes, I don't know if that's the correct word, but they achieve, you know, big time settlements all the time, be it Google or other major industries on misclassification violations.
So what do you, John's comment here is, if Karen is accurate, then this sounds like much ado about nothing. Illinois uses the common law test for tax status classification.
Well, no, it's not much ado about nothing. I mean, if you're an industry that is cheating your independent contractors out of hours they can file a claim with the DOL, and that business can be targeted and audited and fined and all sorts of things. It's not much to do about nothing at all.
Yeah, he's saying that it's done through civil court, not criminal. I don't think that matters, though.
I never said it was done before criminal court. It's
right. That's why. It wouldn't matter.
No, that the Department of Labor can initiate all of these audits and get settlements, major settlements.
So what outside of the gig apps, what is your main concern? What is your other thing?
I was about to say my main income is a gig. Now I'm under a non-disclosure agreement, so I can't say who I work for, but I do financial and logistics consulting for a large company that I be a W-2 employee for. And I don't feel threatened by it because of the only thing we really had to worry about was a non-compete clause with a lot of other people had to sign and did, and I refused because I don't believe in non-compete contracts ever. Mm-hmm. But I'm one of those. I'm not as concerned about this in many areas, partially because an administration change is coming, and I feel like a lot of state with the way they interpret things, like here in my state, there's not going to be any place that's housed in Georgia is not likely going to get hit desperately hard with things.
Well,
like
that's
this.
That's where Kim, that's where they filed was in Georgia.
Yeah. And I don't expect, I guess I'm not as concerned about it as a lot of people would be, because I do believe there are some abuses in the contractor space outside of the gig apps. But I have a much bigger problem with the fact that we use the Fair Labor Standards Act anyway. It's an old rule. It makes no sense anymore. And we have an entire new economy that needs to be redefined that doesn't fit into our current economy now, because we don't have the same company employee relationship that people had 50 years ago. That's the reason why we have a contract economy now. And we need that freedom and flexibility to choose our employers rather than our employers choosing us in a lot of cases. But I'm not sure that this rule specifically is going to be the end all be all of that. And it could be just because I'm not a lawyer and I don't understand as many of the legal implications. If I feel like a contractor is being taken advantage of hours wise, like we have a local manufacturing plant that could get in trouble because I don't think they pay overtime to their contractors, which is like 70% of their workforce right now. I'm not sure I have a problem with them making a claim against that company because they're not being paid properly, because they're not employees.
There's already laws in place for them to be able to do that. You don't have to. Yeah. You don't have to throw everybody overboard in order for a certain industry to be able to, fined for, dirty dealings with independent contractors. And I do agree with you, April, that the FLSA is really antiquated, and this whole rule is antiquated because it's, like I said, it's taking, precedent. They admit it in the rule. It's taking case law dating back 80 years and picking and choosing, and it doesn't take into account the new way that people work. Yeah. And so,
that brings up, of course, we're not going to fall behind the world. Like the world is moving to gig economy more than it ever has, and apps and phones, and I can work from my phone and anywhere. We're not going to fall behind the world.
No, I don't think we will.
Well, then why are they pursuing?
I don't know. That's why you're here.
I mean, my theory,
I'm from California. I have a very different viewpoint of
that. I know, and that's my point. Like California prior to AB5, we all would have said that. No, they won't do this. No way.
Yeah.
And then they didn't.
I look at it like, so and so has an exemption, like dog walkers have an exemption from AB5.
Just WAG, not Rover. There's two apps. One of them does, one of them doesn't.
Well, be that
which as is weird, that's just weird.
It's all confusing. The whole thing is a convoluted mess, and people who think they have an exemption don't really have an exemption at all. And sometimes the Employment Development Department will fine and penalize a business even if they have an outright exemption, because they'll find a way to get you if they want to. You know, and that's what's happening in California all day long, every day since 2020, when AB5 went into effect. And so, you know, that the DOL rule is not going to help people maintain the status quo as independent contractors. It's going to restrict people's ability to be independent contractors. That is a fact, and that is what they want. They want to squelch the trajectory of the independent workforce. They don't want to see all these independent contractors working for themselves and being their own bosses, you know, either by either supplementing their income or as a full-time career or whatever, you know. But as far as real legitimate case, there's always going to be legitimate misclassification and exploitation. You know, of
but there's always been a mechanism in place to challenge that too.
That's right. We don't need these like blanket policies that catch all the dolphins in the tuna net and throw everybody overboard. In California, it was like the Titanic. Everybody was under the purview of AB5 overnight, and the chaos that ensued and the loss of livelihoods was devastating. It was destructive. It was disruptive. It was cruel. It still is. Right now, I'm getting a lot of people coming into my group who are event planners who just cannot comply with AB5 easily and operate under the law. I have an indie filmmaker who says it's, you know, most of the independent filmmakers are leaving California. They can't operate. In California, a theater, if you have that you cannot have an independent contractor whatsoever working in a musical theater production or in a theater, not for a second, not for a minute, not for an hour, not for a day, not for a week. Every single person has to be put on payroll. And so either you operate illegally, or you pay people under the table illegally, or you do what you can to try to comply by begging for money, or you go out of business. And that is what's happening in California, and it's death by a thousand cuts. But the media doesn't talk about it. The media only focuses on Uber and Lyft. And in fact, the media and even allies in our fight get their facts wrong about AB5. They think, I can't tell you how many times I read that AB5 was overturned by Prop 22. Which is
I've actually had people say that to me too, like, well, that doesn't AB5 doesn't exist anymore because Prop 22. And I'm like, what the hell do you mean, dude? That's a carve out.
I had a burlesque singer come into my group yesterday and said, I don't understand. I thought AB5 was overturned. And I said, no, you know, and then I had to explain to her all the facts about it and how the supposed musician exemption isn't all that it appears. And her as a singer, she would only be allowed, even with her quote unquote exemption, she would only be allowed to sing once a week at the same venue. Otherwise, she would have to be made an employee, and she wouldn't be allowed to be an independent contractor for a musical theater production. And she had no idea, because and I said, it's not your fault that you wouldn't know, because I'm reading in major publications like Reuters and Forbes and everything else is people saying that AB5 isn't in effect anymore, you know? And so when people, you know, say that the DOL rule is innocuous and we don't have to worry about it, well, yeah, maybe you're not going to see this just instantaneous you know, sinking of the Titanic and everybody swimming for the nearest lifeboats that we saw with AB5. But what you are going to see is death by a thousand cuts, and you are going to see the chilling effect. And it's the chilling effect that everybody's worried about. It's the chilling effect, because businesses do not want to get it wrong, because the cost of getting it wrong with an independent contractor can, I mean, it could be millions of dollars if you've got a class action coming at you and everything like that.
So I do have to, April mentioned something I need to bring up, because when the, it's like the Julie Sue thing, you know, like, what, like, let's say that in this next election, the candidates swap places. Okay. Let's say that it does turn back to the other way. Won't they just swipe this, or will this not, will this be so entangled it's going to be very difficult to do?
No, they could undo it. And that's why we don't want to be political footballs with every change of administration. And let's think about the other, April thinks that there's going to be a change of administration. What if Biden gets reelected and the Democrats get a very large majority in the Senate and retake the House? The PRO Act is back in play. They'll pass that. And that has the ABC test from California in it for the purposes of collective bargaining in the NLRA. So, you know, this, they are coming for us any way they can do it. And big labor is behind all of it.
Well, we need to mention that in California, they killed off millions of people's careers, livelihoods, their businesses, things they had built. And yet, we were promised, hey, don't worry, we're going to replace them all with jobs. First of all, nobody wanted a job. That was the point. I work for myself. I earned this. I built a business. It's legal in this country. I'm doing it. But they didn't make any jobs. So how do you get rid of 70 million people, which is 40% of the workforce, and not produce anything back anyway, even though those people don't even want those jobs?
They need to look at the new empirical data that was just issued by the Mercatus Center. They did a study of AB5, and it's the first empirical, you know, data study that's ever been done about AB5. Because, you know, before that, it's all been anecdotal, you know, and people just dismiss all of our hundreds and hundreds. I've got thousands and thousands of stories archived in my group that would shock anybody if they took the time to read it and send a chill down your spine. Because if it can happen in California, it can happen nationwide, because the petri dish of bad ideas starts in California. But at any rate, you know, it's just, what was your question again? I forget.
Well, I mean, there was no jobs created in California.
Oh, the Mercatus study. The Mercatus study showed that because of AB5, as a direct result of AB5, there was a substantial loss across the board in employment, regular W-2 employment that could be traced to AB5, and of course, substantial losses in self-employment. So these policies don't work. They don't have that outcome that they say they want to create employment. Of course, creating employment is beneficial to unions, because then they have, you know, they see rideshare and trucking as low-hanging fruit where they can corral as many quote-unquote workers as they can for the purposes of organizing and unionizing to prop up their membership. That's what's going on here.
So John seems to think that the Senate will not grow Dem membership.
The Senate won't?
I don't know. I mean, he's saying the Manchin seat will flip, Arizona will likely stay Democrat, but he's saying Senate will not grow Democrat membership.
Well, Arizona, Senator Sinema was one of our biggest allies, and I met with Senator Sinema and Joe Manchin and Julie Sue in a meeting back in May about this rule in AB5, and Senator Sinema is an independent. And she's not running for re-election, which is too bad, because she was a friend of Freelancers. And so it remains to be seen whether, you know, I think it's, what is it, Carrie Lake and some other Democrat running for that seat now, you know, so it'll probably, you know, turn Democrat. But you don't know what the waves of, you know, the tides, how they will turn. You know, but if Trump were to be reelected, then this DOL rule will probably be rescinded. You know, yeah. But if not, then it becomes like a cancer and it metastasizes in ways that you don't even know how this thing can work its way into the courts and into the legislatures for the purposes of crafting regulations in states that may not have as strict anti-independent contractor labor laws as we do in California. What's happening in Rhode Island right now, mm-hmm. Minnesota, these places are wanting to implement these kinds of ABC tests. And so, and it's the DOL rule is inspired by California's ABC test. They even said so in the proposed rule, the first version of the rule. They actually, the writers actually lauded the ABC test from California and lamented the fact that they couldn't implement it outright verbatim into the Fair Labor Standards Act due to technicalities. But they did they've done everything they possibly can to mimic the ABC test from California in this rule. And what their goal is to create a chilling effect and scare people and scare businesses. So yeah, you might not, what you're more likely going to see is businesses terminating their relationships with independent contractors just out of an abundance of caution.
And so to this, though, yes, Congresswoman Stefanik is on the side of pro-freelancer, I believe, correct?
Yes. In fact, she wrote a op-ed that where she talked about my group and quoted me in her op-ed. She is a very, very, very much a friend of independent contractors, as is Kevin Kiley. But Kevin Kiley is really the driving force, and he has a subcommittee. I testified on his subcommittee before Congress.
And people should listen to him, too, because he's in California. He's lived through AB5.
Right. So I and Kim Cavan, who's in New Jersey, we both, on April 19th of 2023, we testified before his subcommittee in Washington, D.C. It was subcommittee of Virginia Fox's, you know, Education and Workforce Protection Committee. So I was invited to talk about the devastation and destruction of AB5 in front of senators. I mean, not senators, that representatives.
Yeah. So... So we've got yours. There's a few websites. We've got Karen's. I know this is another one, saveindependentwork.org. We've got for you gig workers on gig apps, we have the driver. Why am I trying about the driver rights? Here it is, .org. So it's singular driverrights.org. This will write your congressman as well. Mike Harubi has his Be My Own Boss is on his New Jobs America. So there are websites, and I mean, go to all three, even put your name on all. I don't know, maybe you shouldn't, but I mean, I would say start, because I'm hoping to. We've told people so many times, write your senators or write your congressmen. You know, some people are getting into it and they're doing it, but some people aren't. And so I was hoping there's a different, some other attack we could tell people to do today.
It's really important when you do call your representative in Congress to refer to the resolution 116, which is Kevin Kiley's resolution. And when you call your senator, it's SJ resolution 63. And that's for the Congressional Review Act.
Okay.
You can look it up. In fact, I think if you go to saveindependentwork.org, they have the list of senators that are already co-sponsoring that resolution on the Bill Cassidy's side of the aisle. But what else can you do? You can educate yourself about these anti-independent contracting policies. And you can join a group. You can come into my group, Freelancers Against AB5, and learn all about on Facebook. It's a public group. It's not private. You can go to Fight for Freelancers USA. They've got a ton of information.
Yeah, that's a good one too.
Independent contracting.
That's Kim's, you guys. So
yeah, there's a lot of data points and all sorts of things you can see what they've posted there. They always keep up with the latest and greatest, as do I, in terms of all of the different moving parts with this.
Yeah, and I've seen that Fight for Freelancers now has like each state too. It's got the New Jersey, the Minnesota, I see that they're popping up everywhere, and I love that.
And they need them because there was a task force in Minnesota that I spoke at. They're wanting to implement more restrictive independent contractor labor laws in Minnesota. And, you know, watching it unfold for the last couple, 3 or 4 months, you know, you just see how they run roughshod over all of our concerns. They already had their mind made up. They already had their mind made up, which is exactly what happened in California. So you really have to be vigilant and watch out what your own state legislature is doing with these task force and these bills, because, you know, out of sight, out of mind with AB 5, they, you know, a lot of these states saw what happened, what a disaster AB 5 was and still is, and they don't want to necessarily replicate that. But then they turn around and they want to implement the ABC test anyways. You know, so really what the really is going on here is that we're just roadkill in their ultimate mission. You know, those of us who lose our livelihoods, well, we're just expendable. You know.
Yeah, what does Kim say? We're acceptable collateral damage, or
acceptable collateral damage. That's exactly what happened in California. I mean, they turn a blind eye to our stories. They don't want to hear our AB5 stories. My whole mission for the last 4 years has been to share these horrible stories and let people know that it's not just about Uber and Lyft, as the media have you believe. And, you know, I mean, that's just 5 to 7% of the independent workforce that we're talking about here that are impacted. I mean, I've got pharmacists, you know, who've lost everything because of AB5. Just go through the list: cancer registrars, community theaters, musicians, music stores.
And those are anything I've done with Karen. We've done like 6 things together live. Like if you go to any of the comment or any of the description in the videos of anything Karen and I've done, her stories are in there. The occupations that got killed off are in there, and I'll put them into this ones too. I'll populate the description here with those as well. And other things too, including this. Chris Taylor keeps dropping this, and if you guys haven't noticed, I've been trying to get as many of these as possible. I think they're very powerful. In fact, Karen was asking me, how am I getting people to do this? So because it is hard. It's like pulling teeth.
It is. Your series, Steve, of independent contractors and drivers, you know, doing their testimonials about why they want to remain independent contractors and not become employee drivers. I mean, be careful what you wish for. If that's what you want, those are very powerful. You know, people need to hear people's concerns, policymakers, you know, and the more we can get.
And that's what I was getting at. What do you think of these as opposed to writing in? Because once I get these, anybody can take these in. Like when you asked me if you could take a piece of a video, I'm like, Karen, you can do whatever you want. I mean, I don't, you know, I want you to do whatever helps the cause. So like, I mean, if a gig worker doesn't, if they're like, I'm not going to write my congressman, because I got to tell you, I know a lot who won't.
Well, you can write a letter to the editor, to your newspaper. You can write it.
But I mean, do you think these are powerful? Do you think this is good?
What's really powerful is something like Mike Rowe. He just released it's kind of a dated though. He used a little bit of dated footage. But he just released like a segment documentary type of thing about the PRO Act and the attack on independent contractors and how at AB5 in relation to that. And so I think documentaries is really something that would be a very powerful way to go. And we did.
I saw Kevin Kiley even using videos. So, I mean, they must be powerful, you know?
Right.
I mean, this is... But when you hear somebody's story and them telling it out of their mouth, it's powerful.
The main thing is to stay connected with the advocacy groups like ours or Fight for Freelancers or Save Independent Worker and Independent Women's Forum to find out what's really happening on the ground and the things that you're not going to read about in the media. Because most of the collateral damage from AB5 in California, you're not going to read about it. You're not going to hear about it anywhere other than my group. You know, because right. the media only, they only want to write about truckers and Uber and Lyft and maybe, you know, community theater. They don't think that it applies to anybody else, but we have so hundreds of thousands of people across a vast swath of professions. In fact, Kevin Kiley read all 600
I know
professions that I had collected in a document. Yeah. Yeah. In my group that we identified within my group.
And by the way, guys, the last one, they're in alphabetical order. The last one is YouTube creator.
Yep. YouTube creators.
So, YouTube people, like you're on the chopping block too.
Right. Because these you have to be very careful when you hire an independent contractor. You know, depending on where that independent contractor is based, how many hours you're working with that independent contractor. There are so many landmines, you know, especially in California, where you can just find yourself in a world of hurt if for some reason you get audited by the Employment Development Department or investigated by the Division of Labor Standards Enforcement. The fines and penalties can be astronomical.
So as we wrap this up, I do have to pull up John. I want to pull up John's comment here. He says, I have to go back to the state exemption superseding the DOL rule. Vina Dubal herself back in 2021 said the change of the FLSA is going to supersede any state law. Dubal may have a point in 2021.
I think John watched my our reaction video to all of the bullshit that Vina Dubal spouts.
I was going to call her your friend.
A lot of times she doesn't know what she's talking about. So I would take whatever she has to say with a grain of salt.
Yeah.
Vina Dubal is a law professor who's AB5. She's the president of the AB5 fan club, but she's never read the law.
Yeah.
So,
I mean,
for example, she doesn't know that musical theater production, you cannot hire any independent contractors whatsoever. You can't convert it to a co-op in order to be able to have independent contractors in it with working for a musical theater production. The list goes on with her. But yeah. I can tell you that
communist.
Yeah. as far as superseding, I don't trust my exemption is going to hold up. I have clients in Hawaii, I have a client in Virginia, I have clients in New York, I have a client in Washington, D.C., and I have a client in California. And I don't know that these people are going to take the time to know that I have a frickin' exemption from AB5. They don't care if they see this new DOL rule, even if my exemption's supposed to supersede. They might decide, we're just going to err on the side of caution. We don't want to deal with independent contractors at all.
And that's what I was going to say is that it doesn't matter because in the end, like if I own a business and I want to hire Karen because I've been working with her for years, I'm going to be so scared. I'm just not going to do it.
Right. Yeah. Well, we can't.
It doesn't matter if Karen's calling me saying, no, you're good. I checked into it. That's not probably enough for me as the business owner to go, okay, I'm sure you can.
Yeah. Because as a weekly if I write a weekly column, you know, for a newspaper or publication, and that weekly column is, you know, every week for a year, I violate the permanence factor of the DOL rule. They don't want people to have, they say, well, it's okay to have repeat clients, but they want maybe, but they don't, it has to be like random assignments here and there and one-offs. It can't be something. So, I mean, weekly columnists were really screwed in California. They got when AB5 went into effect, and newspaper cartoonists as well. We had a newspaper cartoonist from the Los Angeles Times who got dumped because of AB5, and major columnists for Forbes and the San Francisco Chronicle and everything lost their columns because of AB5. So yeah. What I'm trying to tell everybody is if it can happen, we're the canary in the coal mine here. If it can happen in California, it can happen anywhere.
Yeah.
And so the worst thing is being complacent. you know, I'm not saying go out on the street with your placard and start, you know, closing down bridges and that kind of thing. But what I'm saying is pay attention and stay aware and be vigilant and keep an eye out on all of these moving parts. And the best way to keep up with what's going on, because it is so confusing, is to just, you know, come into my group or freelance, Fight for Freelancers USA, and all of the latest stuff, you know, accurate information and everything that's breaking news, like, for example, that NLRB judge vacating that joint employer standard, you can find. And so, and you'll be aware, if you live in Minnesota, for example, if you were involved with any of our groups, you would know they're coming for you. There's a task force. They want to implement an ABC test in Minnesota. If you live in Rhode Island and you were a member of our group, you would know that Rhode Island is going to be implementing very strict anti-independent contractor labor laws in the very near future. So just what I'm saying is to stay on top of it, be open-minded, to be educated about these attacks, these multi-pronged attacks from various places, either state on the state level or through these federal workarounds, through regulations and the PRO Act, which we do have to keep an eye on. It's off the table for now, but it could come rearing its ugly head again, just like Glenn Close in the bathroom scene. She'll come popping back up with the knife and screw everybody over with the ABC test from California, which is in the PRO Act. Well, go watch Mike Rowe's recent documentary. It just came out 2 weeks ago. He talks all about the PRO Act. It's a very chilling thing. They do not want to see the independent workforce growing as much as it's growing now. They don't. They're trying to put a clamp down on it.
So again, if you guys are sitting there trying to write down, wait, what the group name, I'm going to populate the description of this video with everything. Kim's site, Karen's group, their handles on Twitter, and anything, like all of it will be in the, you don't need to be writing anything down. It'll, you know, give me about an hour or so after this ends and it will be populated in here. And if you're watching on the replay, it'll already be populated in here. But yeah, that's where we are. And I think it's undefined. We don't know how it'll play out, but I think this is why Karen was a great guest, and I'm glad April was able to join us as well. But Karen has lived through this, and nobody thought it would happen in California. Nobody believed it would actually happen. And when it happened, it wasn't partial. It happened in full. It knocked everybody down.
It did. And go on Twitter too and follow some of the people that Steve was following, like Kim Gavin, Kevin Kiley. Mm-hmm. You know, there are people on Twitter that are keeping you know, up to date with the latest breaking news in the independent contracting, the war on independent contractors. Twitter's a good place to learn about what's going on here.
Yeah. Well, thank you everybody for joining. I see that we've been growing in viewers as it goes on, and we're kind of at that peak height right now too. So usually that's when I keep it going a little longer, but we are, you know, we're going to stop here because that's the information we have. That's what's out there. But I guess my last comment would be to err on the side of caution. Don't think that if you heard somebody say, and you know, this won't be affected or that won't be affected or this, They don't know because that's what everybody in California said. Everybody, this won't affect you.
It's a very obtuse rule. It's a very obtuse, capricious, and arbitrary rule. And anybody who thinks they know how it's gonna land, you know, on any given independent contracting situation is not. I mean, it's there's a whole lot of leeway to find in favor of employee status over independent contractor in this new rule. And it's designed that way. And it's inspired by AB5 and the ABC test of AB5. It is.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you, April. Thank you, Karen. Thank you everybody for joining. And please leave comments on this too, as well. If you're watching on the replay, leave your comments. I'll let Karen know if she's not looking too, because sometimes you guys have questions for Karen when she's on. I'll let her know, hey, there's some YouTube comments. You should come over and check them out. So,
hey, is John still with us?
I think so.
John, you were asking about Olson versus State of California. I just found out the hearing is going to be at 1:30 on March 20th for the on-bank hearing for that. And that is a very, very important case for AB5 coming up real soon.
So he says, yes, he's still here. Okay. Yeah, guys, if you came in late, go back and watch from the start, because it did start today. I mean, and like we all said, nothing will happen today. We said that months ago. You're not going to see anything today.
Well, we did with the tutoring company. Their tutors in New Jersey and Massachusetts are out of work as of today.
Really?
Yes, because of the rule.
Like immediately today?
Immediately today.
Okay. So there we go. That's, you know, everybody was like, well, this is going to take forever. Like, okay, well, okay. We already know one's done in the first day. Like nobody knows how it'll roll out. Nobody knows where it'll go. Nobody knows who it'll come after. But if you are an independent contractor, you're at risk. Sadly. So do something. Make a video, upload. I'm gonna put all of it, guys, into the show notes. The Twitter handles, the websites, the groups on Facebook, anything, and join them. Whatever your favorite pick your poison. Whatever your favorite platform is, get on there, pick one of them, follow these people, look at what they're saying, because there's some great information out there, and there's some people who just even need, if you're on Twitter, retweets, things like that, to get it in other people's eyes. Because the more people that see all this, the better, because we need to get loud about this, because California didn't have time to get loud. And by the time it happened, it had happened. It was over.
Yep.
So again, thank you, everybody. And we'll see you back here next time.
Thanks,
Steve.
Have
a good day. And we'll talk to you soon.
She was just a baby. Hey, no baby.